During the Second World War, a ship left Europe with 500 to 600 Jewish folks in it. They were refugees. Wealthy, well-known Jewish people escaped from Europe when Hitler came to power. Einstein, Sigmund Freud, they got out. The rest of them had a great difficulty in escaping Europe, but there were 500 to 600 of them on an old cargo ship that left Europe to escape refugees, and they came to America. They docked in New York Harbor, and the State Department said, no, these people cannot get off that boat. We don't want these people in America. Hard to believe, but it actually happened. The ship went down to Havana, same story. They're Jewish people, we don't want them. Three or four other ports turned that boat down, and finally it had to return to Europe, where all those people were put to death by Adolf Hitler. Hard to believe, but it actually happened in history. You know, that ship of doom was supposed to be a ship of hope. And what anticipation those people must have had as they got aboard that ship and finally escaped Nazi Europe. What a blessing. But how awful events turned on those people. Reminds me a little bit about our study tonight. We are in the book of Zechariah today. We're in the first chapter still, and we're going to pick up right in verse 16. If you want to open there in God's Word, we're going to get started. Let's look to the Lord in a word of prayer, shall we? Lord God, thank you for the book of Zechariah and for the prophetic events we're going to be looking at. I pray that your words might be made clear. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. The nation of Israel is in dire straits. They are like a ship, people on a ship of hopelessness. And they don't know what in the world is going to happen. They're having nothing but problems. They're back in the land after 70 years of being in Babylon. Things are not going well. The Arabs, surprise, surprise, are mocking them and giving them a hard time. Well, sir, the prophet Zechariah pulls out his telescope, and he pulls it out. Remember those old-time telescopes? You want to look a long distance, they pull the thing out, telescope. And he looked in his telescope right on down yonder through history, past the age we're living in today. The prophet Zechariah is going to foretell the future of the nation of Israel. I'm reading in verse 16. Therefore, thus says the Lord, I am returning to Jerusalem with mercy. My house shall be built in it, says the Lord of hosts, and a surveyor's line shall be stretched out over Jerusalem. Again proclaims, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, my city shall again spread out through prosperity. The Lord will again comfort Zion, and he will again choose Jerusalem. Now, somebody can say, well, Jack, isn't that talking about Zechariah's time? It is. But it has a double meaning, a double prophecy, we call it. Look at verse 3, the last half. Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls because of the multitude of men and livestock in it. For I, says the Lord, will be a wall of fire around her, and I will be a glory in her midst. That never happened. This is talking, my friends, about the coming of the Lord Jesus to this earth. The nation Israel is going to be preserved and has been for 2,000 years and will continue to be preserved until the end times when Jesus comes back to set up his glorious kingdom. That ship of doom is a ship of hope for the nation of Israel. The world has written them off for the most part. Listen to, again, verse 10, same chapter. Sing and rejoice, O daughter of Zion, for behold, I am coming, and I will dwell in your midst. This is God speaking. I will dwell in your midst. God's coming to dwell in your midst. Doesn't get any better than that for Israel. Many nations shall be joined to the Lord in that day, and they shall become my people, and I will dwell in your midst. Then you will know that the Lord is host has sent me to you. Get that? The Lord of hosts has sent me to you. This is remarkable because it's very plainly talking about the Lord Jesus. God the Father is sending God the Son back to this planet. It belongs to him. It's his property. Man is a tenant And he's a bad tenant, by the way. He's messed up God's property. He's polluted it. He's done everything wrong. And now God is coming back, and he's going to have a foreclosure, if you will. And he is going to kick out all the transgressors, and God's people will again be established in the city of Jerusalem, yea, indeed, in the land of Israel. And God himself shall dwell in their midst. Listen to the rest of this verse. And I will dwell in their midst, then you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you. And the Lord will take possession of Judah as his inheritance in the Holy Land, and will again choose Jerusalem. Be silent, all flesh, before the Lord, for he is aroused from his holy habitation. The good news is, the good news for the world is, even though it is wicked and evil, and even though the Lord Jesus predicted wars and rumors of wars and great difficulties before the end, it's all going to be good after all is said and done. Because Jesus is coming back and is going to repossess this planet. And he's going to stamp out all wars. Is that good news or what? I remember talking to a very progressive friend of mine. This is 40, 50 years ago now. And he was from New York City, and he wasn't a Christian. And he always talked about how much he hated wars. And I hate wars too. And I was sharing with him about how someday there's not going to be any wars. The Bible says the swords shall be turned into pruning hooks. And man's not going to be fighting against his fellow man anymore. The nations will be at total peace. And he said to me, Jack, oh, I'd like to be a part of that kingdom. I would just love to be a part of that wonderful, peaceful kingdom. And I shared with him, you can if you accept Jesus as your personal Savior. The ship of doom is a ship of hope. And yes, they are storm-tossed and rejected by the world. I'm talking about Israel. But someday God's got a wonderful port for them that ship is going to enter, and they are going to reign and rule over this earth with Messiah Jesus in Jerusalem. That's the hope. That's the promise that God has given to his Jewish people. And by the way, you probably won't be too shocked to know that many people don't believe what I've just shared with you. Unfortunately, the reason they don't believe, for the most part, is because they belong to a movement that was part of the Reformation. Martin Luther, John Calvin were both Catholic priests. And what the Catholicism taught was that replacement theology, that Israel is kaput, fini, over with, and the church now has supplanted Israel, and God is done with the nation of Israel, period. And any promises you see in the Bible concerning Israel is a promise to the church. Martin Luther and John Calvin fought tooth and nail for justification by faith. They had to hold on tightly to salvation because that was the main issue, that this was a secondary issue. And so when they came out with justification by faith, but they came out with bad eschatology, bad future events. They came out with Catholic teaching that, by the way, was based on anti-Semitism. It was the Catholic Church that persecuted Jewish people during the Inquisition. If you don't become a Catholic, you're going to die. And they were tortured. And the Crusades, five or six of them that came down all the way to Jerusalem, when they found Jewish people, they very often burnt them alive in their own synagogues. The Catholic Church has been guilty of anti-Semitism for 2,000 years. And when Adolf Hitler was putting Jewish people in the ovens, the Pope said nothing, nothing. And when the war was over, it was the Catholic Church that was ferreting these criminal, Nazi criminals through a pipeline off to South America to safety. The Catholic Church is not the friend of Christianity. They have horrible theology. And one of the bad teachings that came out of the Reformation was this one, that the church has been replaced, not the church, but Israel has been replaced by the church. No. God made a promise to the man Abraham. Through your seed, I'm going to bless all the nations of the world, and you are going to, and your inhabitants, have this land from the river in Egypt to the Euphrates forever. Do you think that God breaks his promises? I can assure you he does not. The nation Israel has never possessed the land in its totality, but they will someday. Don't try to spiritualize God's word away. That's always a terrible, terrible mistake. And by the way, this storm-tossed ship that the nation of Israel is on, there's a reason for it. If you back up in your Bibles to verse 18, here's reason the nation Israel is so storm-tossed and so rejected by the world and so persecuted. Verse 18, the prophet Zechariah speaking, "Then I raised my eyes and looked, and there were four horns. And I said to the angel who talked with me, 'What are these?' So he answered me, 'These are the horns that have scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem.'" Four horns have scattered the nation of Israel. Who could those four horns be? Horn speaks of power, like a horn of a bull or horn of a ram. Four, though, four. Babylonian Empire scattered Judah. Mede-Persian Empire scattered Israel and persecuted Israel. The Greek Empire was terrible, terrible to the Jewish people, terrible to them. And the Roman Empire, the fourth one, also did awful things to Jewish people, think 70 AD. And the Jewish people being led captive into all the nations of the world. Four horns persecuting the nation of Israel. But now look. So he said, "These are the four horns that scattered Judah, so that no one could lift up his head. But the craftsmen are coming to terrify them, to cast out the horns of the nations that lifted up their horn against the land of Judah to scatter it." Oh, yes, there's four horns. Oh, yes, they have scattered Judah. Yes, they persecuted the Jewish people from its inception, from Babylon onward. Jesus called it the time of the Gentiles. On the calendar, the Jewish calendar, before the Babylonian captivity, I can assure you, Jewish people would never govern time by Gentile calendars. They used their own. We are 500 years from the Passover or since Moses, whatever. But now, this is a time of Darius. This is a time of the Gentiles. Gentiles are coming down, have come down very hard on God's people. But it has been, in fact, a judgment from God himself, a discipline for his Jewish people. Four horns, but then there's going to be four craftsmen, God says. And that's got a positive note to it. What does that mean? Well, a craftsman, particularly if he works with wood, he's a guy, or iron, he straightens things out. He's a craftsman. He doesn't like sloppy work. The nation of Babylon persecuted God's people overboard, more than God wanted them to do it. And God raised up a craftsman to straighten out Babylon, was the Mede-Persian Empire. And Babylon was destroyed in one day and humbled, put in their place, straightened out, put back in their box where they needed to be. But then the Mede-Persians were all arrogant and puffy. That's the crowd that put Daniel in the lion's den. They were a nasty crowd too. And they got all lifted up with pride. And God needed a craftsman to straighten them out. And so he raised up another empire. And that, of course, would have been the Greek Empire, Alexander the Great. And Alexander came down, and he had a very small army, but it was very swift, and he was a very good general. And within a matter of a few years, he conquered the Mede-Persians, set up his headquarters in Babylon, and he died a drunk there at 33 years of age. But he was a craftsman. He put the Mede-Persians back in the box where they belonged and humbled that nation, and they went on the ash heap of history the same way as the Babylonian Empire did. But Alexander the Great and his generals were not very nice people either, particularly to the Jewish race. Consider the Hellenistic teaching that a lot of the Jews adhered to, and boy, did they ever have a terrible time of unity in a nation of Israel because of it. Well, sir, they got all puffed up too, so God raised up another craftsman. It was the Roman Empire. And the Roman Empire conquered the Greece Empire. And Alexander the Great, he was kaput. on Ash Heap of History. That craftsman straightened them out. Well, you're going to say, now, who straightened out the Roman Empire? There wasn't an empire after that. Not yet, but there is one coming. Do you remember when Daniel interpreted Nebuchadnezzar's dream? Nebuchadnezzar had a terrifying dream. He saw an awesome idol, a statue. He didn't call it an idol. He called it a statue in his dream. And it had a gold head. It had silver arms, brass, steel legs, 10 toes. It was awesome. And Daniel was called in. And he said, Daniel, can you interpret this dream? These soothsayers, this bunch of phonies I got around here that I probably pay way too much to, they don't know what it means. Can you tell me what it means? He said, yeah, there's a God in heaven, and here's what it means. Four empires. You are the head of gold. It's going to follow you. It's going to follow you, the Mede-Persians. And then it's going to be the Greek Empire. And then there's going to be those two legs. It's the Roman Empire, East and West Division. But listen, there is another empire coming. And he is a craftsman. He's going to straighten out the Roman Empire. And who is that one who's going to straighten out the Roman Empire? And by the way, the empire that Jesus is going to straighten out is the revived Roman Empire, consisting of 10 toes. The Empire of Rome dissolved, disappeared a couple thousand years ago, 1500. But it's going to be revived again in the last days. The Antichrist will come from those 10 nations of Europe. But then Daniel says, you know, as I was watching this big statue that you, this dream you had, Nebuchadnezzar, I noticed a great big boulder coming from the sky. And it was a remarkable boulder because it wasn't cut out with hands. And it came and it struck the statue at its feet. And the whole thing toppled over and blown away of the wind. And that big rock filled up the whole earth. That will be the one that straightens out the Roman Empire. That will be the craftsman of all craftsmen. Jesus will set up his kingdom upon this earth after that happens. That's why the Bible says the earth will be filled with the knowledge of God. So the nation Israel, boy, they have got some history, do they not? Talk about troubles. They are on a ship of doom, a lot of them think. But God's got a port for them. I want you to turn with me, if you wouldn't mind, to the prophet Isaiah, 14th chapter. Very important theology we're talking about tonight. God's word, when we study it, is to be taken literally. That's called hermeneutics, biblical interpretation. God says something, I believe it. And I would never attempt to spiritualize it away and make it say something that it doesn't say. And you need to do exactly the same thing, too, as you study God's word. Now, sometimes God will give an illusion. He'll give a picture. He'll say, oh, a woman riding a beast with 10 horns. Well, the woman happens to be the city of Babylon, and the beast happens to be the Roman Empire. He gives the interpretation. But we have no right to take God's word and twist it into something that it's not. God says he promised this man, Abraham, that he is going to give him and his descendants a land forever. That's exactly what he means. The Bible says that God watches over his word to perform it. Listen to this, the 14th chapter. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob, that's verse 1, and will still choose Israel, and settle them in their own land. Did you get that? Settle them in their own land. If I was reading this 100 years ago, the audience would be scoffing, because for 2,000 years, the land of Israel was a howling desert with nobody living there, few Arabs. But now they've come back to the land, 1948, but that's not the coming that Isaiah is talking about. He is talking about the final ingathering, because these people in the land today are going to be taken out of the land. We're going to see that in this chapter. But God's going to bring them back. And will still choose Israel. That's verse 1. And settle them in their own land. And strangers will be joined with them, and they will cling to the house of Jacob. Now drop on down to verse 3. And it shall come to pass the Lord, when the Lord gives rest from your sorrow and from your fear and your hard bondage in which you were made to serve, that you will take up this proverb against the king of Babylon and say, how the oppressor has ceased. Let me stop right there. When your hard labor and bondage is over, that's not today, but it's coming. These people, one more time, are going to be taken out of the land of Israel. And somebody can say, well, how do you know that, Jack? Because Jesus said so. 17th chapter of Luke. They'll be led captive into all nations. For the last time, they will be taken out. And we're going to see even in this book of Zechariah that this indeed is true. God's enemies are going to prevail one more time for a very short period of time in relation to Israel. And the Bible says that God himself, the Lord Jesus, will return from heaven and he will gather his elect from the four winds where they've been scattered. The elect is elect Israel, not the church, and gather the Jewish people back to the land, the final ingathering. By the way, a fulfillment of the promise that God made to that man, Abraham. God keeps his promises. He's not like us. He's not unfaithful. And then when they come back, they've got a little proverb they're putting together. And look what they're saying. How the oppressor has ceased. He's talking about the king of Babylon. Who would that be? Nebuchadnezzar? No. The city of Babylon is predicted is going to be rebuilt. It's already been half constructed by that guy that was killed, hung. I'm talking about Saddam Hussein. And it's going to be fully reconstructed. And during the 7-year tribulation period, the Antichrist is going to reign from Babylon. And Jerusalem too, back and forth, just like Nebuchadnezzar did. And the Jewish people at the second coming after Antichrist is killed and Jesus is back in Jerusalem are going to be saying this little proverb. How the oppressor has ceased. Amen. The golden city, that's Babylon, has ceased. And it'll be destroyed in 1 hour, the Bible says. And the sailors, the people on the ocean who do business with Babylon are going to see the smoke go up in a huge plume. It's going to burn because God's going to destroy Babylon in 1 hour. That never happened the first time. The Lord has broken the staff of the wicked. That's verse 5. The scepter of rulers. He who struck the people in wrath with continual stroke. The references to the Antichrist, the false Messiah, the king of Babylon. What did he do? He struck the people in wrath with a continual stroke. Jesus said those times are going to be so dangerous, Matthew 24, that for the elect's sake, God is going to have to intervene, otherwise no flesh would be saved. Time of trouble coming upon the world, if God didn't interject himself, nobody would survive. And here we see it. He who ruled the nations in anger, that's the Antichrist, is persecuted and no one hinders. He got his just deserts. Jesus is going to take care of folks like this. The whole earth, here it is, verse 7, is at rest. Not wonderful? The whole earth is at rest and quiet. Why? Remember, we talked about a false peace in Zechariah's time. Zacharias was talking to an angel, and he said, what have you been doing? He said, well, I've been traveling over all the earth to find out what in the world is going on. And we discovered the world is quiet and at rest, but it was a phony rest, a phony peace, because Israel was still in trouble and persecuted. Mark it well, there will not be peace in this planet. There will not be peace in this planet until Israel is at peace with her God. When Israel says, where did you receive these nail prints in your hands? When Jesus comes back to the Mount of Olives, and he says, I received these in the house of my friends. They said they're going to mourn for him as one mourns over an only son. They're going to recognize he was here before. This is the Messiah. We rejected him 2,000 years ago. And they're going to embrace him and weep the way that Joseph wept and embraced his 11 brothers that sold him down the river. And Israel will be reconciled to God. The Bible says the whole nation is going to be born again in one day. All Israel shall be saved, the Bible says. A deliverer will come from Zion, and all Israel shall be saved. Then there will be peace worldwide, legitimate. Without peace with God, there's no peace on this planet. Listen to this. The whole earth is at rest and quiet. They break forth into singing. Now you got something to sing about, brother. Now verse 9. And here God pulls back the veil, and he shows us something we would never know in a million years unless he showed us. He's going to show us the judgment of the Antichrist and Satan himself. This is the one that's causing the turmoil for the Jewish people for thousands of years. This is the one that raised up Lake Galilee so that the 11 disciples almost drowned. If Jesus had not been in the boat and said, "Peace, be quiet, be muzzled," he said, and the sea became like glass, they would have all drowned. This is the one responsible for sending those Jewish people on that ship of doom back to Europe to go into Hitler's concentration camps. This is the one. You're not going to receive justice in this world, but God's going to even the scales out. Justice comes from him. And here we see Satan and his minions and the false Messiah receiving their just deserts. Listen to this. This is astounding. I'm reading in verse 9. Hell from beneath is excited about you to meet you at your coming. Brother, that's not going to be a happy coming. It stirs up the dead for you, all the chief ones of the earth, all the people who were dead, the Gentiles that perished during the tribulation period. Now the chief, the big shot, the one who ruled the world, the one who commanded the world to worship his idol or they would die, this one finds himself in hell. It begins at Armageddon when Jesus comes back. Satan, who inhabits this man of sin, is cast into a lake of fire. But the man of sin himself, his body goes into a grave and is eaten by maggots. But his spirit goes down below to Hades, and he's greeted by all these people that he knows. And they say, "Wow, you're coming, become a nothing, a nobody, just like us." My, the grave has a way of equalizing things, doesn't it? It is raised up from their thrones, all the kings of the nations, and they will speak and say to you, "Have you also become weak as we?" This is quite a greeting party here. Have you become as weak as we? Yeah. Have you become like us? They're astounded. This man of sin who is so powerful and so supernatural and seemingly so unconquerable finds himself in hell. Your pomp is brought down to Sheol, to the grave, and the sound of your stringed instruments. The maggot is spread under you and worms cover you. Comes to a bad end, folks. Then it says in verse 16, those who see you will gaze at you and consider you, saying, "Is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook the kingdoms, who made the world as a wilderness and destroyed its cities, who did not open the house of its prisoners?" That's exactly who it is. The one who destroyed the world. Visit New York City or any city of this planet and look around at the great buildings that man has put together. Someday they're all going to be laying on the ground, just like 9/11, all of them. Because the Antichrist is a man of destruction. He's going to destroy the world and make it like a wilderness. Can you even imagine? But now we see this one is judged. He is in hell. He's getting his just deserts. God is faithful. And by the way, is it any wonder why the devil hates us so much? You know the difference between the devil and a lot of folks, most people, the difference is Satan believes the Bible. They don't. Do you want to know why he believes the Bible, Satan? Because he recognizes God's words. And he's smart enough to know that when God says something, it always comes to pass. Remember, Jesus cast the demons out, that demoniac, in that tomb. The demons said to him, "Are you come to judge us before the time?" How did they know about judgment? Because they read the Bible. That's why, and they believed it. "We know you are the Son of God. Have you come to judge us before the time?" The devil believes the Bible. By the way, if you have any questions about what we're looking at tonight, about the return of Israel, judgment of Antichrist, here's a good reason to believe it. God says, "Listen, I know that some folks are very stubborn. So I'm going to tell you events before they come to pass, so you'll know when they do come to pass, I'm the one that told you. This prophet Zechariah foretold that Jesus would be betrayed by one of his friends for 30 pieces of silver." Remember, Zechariah was written in 500 years before Jesus was even born. How did Zacharias know that? Zechariah prophesied Messiah would have nail prints in his hands. He said that before the Greek Empire came into power. The Greeks were the ones that invented crucifixion, not the Romans. How did he know Messiah would have nail prints in his hands 500 years before Jesus was born? Because he's a prophet of God. If those things came to pass, and they did, why would you question anything else that this man, Zechariah, has to say? Zechariah prophesies the coming again of the Jewish people back to the land. The ship of doom is a ship of hope. And God's got a port for that ship. And brother, it's heading for that port. And someday, God's going to bless that nation of Israel. He loves those folks. And that crowd around today, some of them teaching mass propagation that God is done with the nation of Israel, is pure baloney. Apostle Paul says, the 11th chapter of Romans, don't take my word for it, read it yourself. Has God then forsaken his people? God forbid. That's his answer, God forbid. I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning this great mystery, this is Romans 11, concerning Israel, that a partial hardening has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. Did you get that? A partial hardening has happened to Israel. Until the Gentiles come in, the church, God has put Israel on the shelf, and he's dealing with Jew and Gentile today, bringing them into a body, baptizing them in a body, but someday he's going to be done with the church. He's going to rapture that church into his presence, and then he's going to turn his attention back to his people Israel. Listen to the verse again. I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning this mystery. Partial hardening has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in, and thus all Israel shall be saved. Israel is Israel, not the church. Paul says, give no offense either to Jew or to Gentile or to the church of God. There's three types of folks, Jew, Gentile, church of God. Don't get them all mixed up. And for goodness sake, don't take one little verse out of Galatians that talks about the Israel of God and try to build a whole theology on it. You can't. When Paul says, blessings be to the Israel of God, he's talking about Jewish people in a Gentile church. They were the true Israel because they were born again Jews. A Jew becomes born again. He doesn't become a Gentile. He becomes a completed Jew. He's still a Jew. Very important. Make that distinction. God's not done with Israel, folks. He's got a plan. He's got a purpose. Jeremiah, I know the plans I have for you, God says. Plans for prosperity, plans for good. I got a plan for you. A lot of folks take that and apply that to himself. That's fine, but that promise was given to the nation of Israel. I have a plan for you, a plan for prosperity, to do good for you in the end, to do good. Gifts and callings of God are without repentance. He called that man Abraham and his seed and brother. He's going to keep his word. I'm very grateful that God keeps his word, aren't you? Because I don't keep God's word, and probably you don't do it so well yourself sometimes, but God keeps his part of the bargain always. The Bible says, even though we're faithless, God's faithful. He can't deny himself. You know, there's a story, and it was actually, I think it started as a poem. I think it was called Footprints in the Sand, and a man wrote a song around that concept, but it's a wonderful concept. It's an analogy. A man dies and he goes to heaven. He's at the judgment seat of Christ, and God is going over his history, his service to him, and he uses the analogy of he walked along the sand with this brother. Jesus did. And the brother said, look, Lord, look in the sand. There's my footprints, and there's you walking right alongside of me. This is just wonderful. But, Lord, I notice that as we walk down the road here that somehow your footprints disappeared, and I see just my footprints. And, Lord, where were you? This was when I was having great difficulty and great problems. Where were you? And Jesus turned to him and said, son, I didn't go anywhere. Those footprints were mine. I was carrying you during those great trials and difficulties that you were going through. Child of God is never forsaken by Jesus. His words are, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. That ship of doom for the nation of Israel, same thing. Oh, they've got a captain at the helm. But Jesus is standing in the shadows, and he's the actual captain. And even though they're going through terrible storm today, and there's a huge storm coming called the tribulation period, the day of Jacob's trouble, he is going to be the captain at the helm. He's going to make sure that that ship comes safely to shore with his Jewish people. You know, Joseph was looking over his 11 good-for-nothing brothers that sold him down the river. He didn't turn his back on them. Remember all the food he gave them and gave them their money back? He was looking out for them. They didn't know who he was. They didn't have the slightest idea who Joseph was. They thought he was dead and gone. Hadn't seen him for 20 years. But he was the Pharaoh's right-hand man, the prime minister of the most powerful nation on the earth, Egypt. And he was looking out for them. Lord Jesus is the most powerful person in the universe, and he's gone back to heaven. But he's looking out for the Jewish people. He's looking out for his church. He's watching over them. He's being faithful to them. He's carrying them when it's necessary. He's going to see us right through to the end. Him we can trust. Isn't that wonderful? Well, I'm going to leave it off right there for today. We're going to pick up next time in the third chapter of Zechariah and continue on these very interesting, I think, prophecies. Prophecy is remarkable, is it not? I want to thank you for joining us today. If we can help you here at the Discipleship Hour, you be sure to email us if you have any questions at jack@thediscipleshiphour.com. I'll do my very best to answer you. And by the way, you got friends that are interested in God's Word, turn them on to the broadcast. We want to get more and more people watching and hearing God's Word, don't we? That's what it's really all about. Thanks for joining us today, and may the Lord bless you. Until next time.